what is a data science? So as we have discussed that, a data science is nothing but a collection of technologies, a collection of techniques what we are going to use. Starting from collecting the data, storing the data, handling the data, cleansing, data analytics, so everything. So whatever that is required to work with the data, that is what we are going to call it as this particular data science. Data science is nothing but one interdisciplinary area where we are going to use some various scientific techniques. So where we are going to use some scientific techniques and we are going to use some systems and we are going to use some methodologies. So to get some insights, so scientific techniques we are going to use to get some insights and some knowledge from the data. Maybe it's a structured or it may be an unstructured data. So once again, just if you recap the last session once again. So as we have discussed that anything that is required to work with the data is nothing but which are part of the data science. So as part of our discussions, what we have been got discussed is whenever we talk about this one, so starting from handling the data, so like we are going to take some help of the big data. So handling the data, structured or unstructured data. Secondly, we are going to go for the data cleansing. We are going to go for a data cleansing. And after that, we are going to go for something called as a data analytics. And apart from that, we are going to do some data visualization. And after that, we are going to discuss about something called as one of the important concept called as machine learning. So as I discussed about that, handling the data is nothing but one kind of handling the data is nothing but something like storing the data. It may be a structured or unstructured data. And apart from that, the coming to the data cleansing, identifying some inaccuracy in the data and incomplete data or missing values to be handled. We are going to do it by using something called as a data cleansing techniques. We are going to use analyzing the data, this understanding the data, data visualization, storytelling skills, and apart from that, machine learning. So today I'm going to discuss about something about a concept called as machine learning. I'm going to discuss it. Yeah, Gopi Krishna, do you have any? Yeah, Gopi Krishna Putraju, you have raised the hand. So any queries from your side? If you have any queries, just you can use the chat panel. So we are going to use this the machine learning. So what is exactly the machine learning? Yeah, Deepak, yesterday, hope you attend the yesterday session. So yesterday we have just discussed about this particular what is the data science. So just I'm just making a review of that particular thing. So handling the data, so data science is something about, so starting from handling the data up to the data visualization and doing some machine learning. So anything to work with the data science, all these techniques, whatever we are going to use is going to be comes under the data science. So you may be working on a handling of data. You may be working on the data cleansing techniques. You may be working on the data analytics part, data visualization and the machine learning concepts. So for this, we are going to use the languages like R and the Python. So I'm going to be an expert on the R. So first, initially, we are going to work with the R. And along with that, even we are going to have a training on a little bit introduction about the Python. How to do the same machine learning and all these things by using Python also, we are going to work on that particular application. And as I told you, it's a free course. So which is going to be for 3 weeks of time, where you will be getting some a little bit hands-on experience of this particular, what is this machine learning? So what exactly this machine learning here is? Yesterday, we discussed about the information about what is a machine learning. So machine learning is something nothing but similar to the human learning. How a human is going to learn. A human is going to learn depending on his past experience. Is going to be past experience. It's machine learning is not a language, or is machine learning is not a it's not a technology. So machine learning is a technique which we are going to implement by using R and Python. Not only by using R and Python, we can do it by using various languages: R, Python, Java, C, C++. Even we can use Plunk. We are having a lot of languages are there. Vika, and we are having Spark. All these are going to be comes under the machine learning algorithms. Okay, so at the end of the question, at the end of the session, I'll answer all the questions. If you have any questions, so you can just we'll discuss at the end of the class. Okay, so coming to the machine learning, it is something similar to the human learning. How a person is going to learn, how a person is going to start to learn, over the experience, over the past experience. So maybe some of you people are already working in the companies. Whenever we join in the company, if you evaluate your performance, so the performance may not be 100%. Maybe your performance may be only somewhere around 50%. Over the time period, you will be getting the experience. So over the experience, the efficiency is going to be gets increases. That is what how a human is going to be gets learning. Same as it is, coming to the machine learning, it is going to develop. So machine itself is going to be gets learning. Yesterday I discussed about definition of a machine learning. So it was developed by a person called as a Sir Samuel. So Arthur Samuel, he is one of the employee in the IBM. So he was one of the pioneer in artificial intelligence and the gamings. He developed this terminology called as the machine learning. So what is exactly the machine learning terminology says is, we are giving the ability to the system, to the machine, to learn without having any explicit coding. We are not going to use any explicit coding further. The machine is going to start learning from itself. That is what generally we are going to call it as the machine learning. So coming to the concept about this particular machine learning, what exactly we are going to do that? So I'll tell you a simple example. I'll tell you, ask you a simple mathematical concepts. Like for example, let us say that sometimes in your WhatsApps and the Facebooks, you will be getting to getting some messages saying that, can you solve this? For example, if x is 10 and y is, let us say I'm giving some two values, x and y. If x is 1 and y is, for example, 10. If x is 2 and y is equals to 20. And if x is 3 and if y is equals to 30. And if x is 4 and y is equals to 40. Now, if I ask you what is the value for 5, anybody can answer this particular question. Why? Because you can clearly see the relation between the y and the x variable. So what is the relation between the y and the x variable is nothing but y is equals to 10 into x value. That is an expression, it's very clearly visible to us. But whenever we go for a real time, this particular data and all these things may not be directly visible for us. So now if I ask you what is the value for y, anybody can answer this, which is going to be 50. And if x is 500, anybody can answer this, that is nothing but 5000 is the value. But whenever we have given a values like this, let us say x is equals to 1 and y equals to 14. If x is 2 and y is equals to 18, and if it is going to be 3 and if it is going to be 22, and if it is going to be 26. Now, if I ask the question, what is the value if it is 5? Anybody can go for this answer for this. Let us say it is going to be 14, 18, 22, 26. So anybody can answer this, 5 is nothing but equals to, it is going to be 30 is the value. But suddenly if I ask you what is the value if it is 500, then you may not be in a position to answer this particular question. So I hope you remembered in mathematics, this is a linear data. As you know that, what do you mean to say linear data? A linear data is nothing but whenever I plot this data on the graph, whenever I plot this data on a graph, the data is going to be something like a linear data. Like whenever I plot it here, for example, I'm plotting it on a graph. So whenever I plot this data on a graph, what happens now? For example, let us say that this is an x-axis and this is the y values. X is 1, y is 2, and x is 3. Let us say y is 4, etc. And the values of this one is going to be, we are having something like, let us say something like 14, 18, and 22, and 26. So whenever we plot this particular data, what happens now? So the data, whatever we can see the plotting here, it is going to be exactly a linear line. It is going to be a straight line is going to be gets coming here. A straight line is going to be gets coming here. So whenever we plot this particular data, so whenever we talk about a linear line, we know that this is going to fix into the expression called as y is equals to m of x plus c is going to be the expression what it is going to be gets coming. So once if we can identify the mathematical formula, so easily we can predict the value of y with the value of the x, where we know that m is nothing but something called as a slope, and you know the slope is nothing but the difference in y with respect to the difference of the x, and c is nothing but what we are going to call it as the intercept we are going to call it as. What is this particular intercept? Intercept is nothing but where the line touches that particular y-axis, where it is crossing the y-axis. It's not exactly the same correct graph actually. I have written it just like an estimation. So it is going to be collecting the values, this one. So if we can identify the relation between these two, so automatically easily we can identify the value of the 500. I think the value is going to be, slope is very visible to us. Slope is going to be y. Slope is equals to 4. I think the expression is equals to y is equals to it is going to be 4x, 4 into x plus it is going to be somewhat, I think 4 is the difference actually, and where it is going to touches that particular value. So y equals to 4 into 1 plus I think it is going to be 4, I think it's going to be 10, I think, maybe, I can't say exactly, it is going to be, I think exactly it is the same. So x is equals to and y is equals to 14. So you can check it out, 4 into 1 plus 10, 14, 4 into 2, it is going to be 8 plus 10 is going to be 18, 4 into 3, 12 plus 10, it is going to be 22, and 4 into 4, it is going to be 16 plus 26, it is going to be 26 is a value. Now, once if you know the expression here, this is going to be values, which is going to be something like 500 is nothing but 4 into x, that is nothing but 4 into 500, which is going to be nothing but 2000. It is going to be 2010 will be the value. But this pattern is very clearly visible to us. But whenever we go for the real times, this data may not be that much predictable. We cannot identify the pattern properly. The same thing, if I give it to the machine is going to identify the relationships. In R and the Python, we are having some, not only in R and Python, in machine learning, we have some machine learning algorithms. Whenever we find the relationships, how to find the correlation between the variables. So these kind of learnings is nothing but what we are going to call it as. So we are giving the data to the machine. Machine is going to do the prediction. So for sample example, I have given you how the machine is going to be gets learning. This is what we are going to work as part of that particular machine learning algorithms. So now what I'm going to work on this one is, now what we are going to work on this particular machine learning here is, the exactly speaking, what do you mean to say machine learning? Whatever the past data, over the history only it can understand it. So over the past data, it is going to go, the past data if we give it to the machine, machine is going to develop the predictive model. Machine is going to develop the predictive model. As I told you, machine learning is basically into the predictive analysis. One predicts the, it is going to develop the predictive model. Like example, I have given you, it will predict the values of m, and that is the slope, and it is going to predict the value of that particular intercept. So that is going to be gets done based on this particular machine learning algorithms. So how we are going to work on that? So it is going to be how we are going to work on that. So give the past data, machine is going to be takes the data, analyzes, and it is going to develop a predictive model. We have a different kinds of algorithm will be used. How we are going to work on that. So as part of a machine learning engineer, yesterday I have given you an introduction about what is the difference between a machine learning engineer and a data scientist. So data scientists are different people who generates their own data. The research people will be there. They will write the algorithms. We are just only using the algorithms for developing a predictive model. So as a machine learning engineer, our role is basically to make the machine. I'm not developing the model, make the machine to develop the model. Or we can say that it is used to train the model. It is used for making the machine to train that particular model. How the machine learning engineer is going to get works? Make the machine to train the model. But if I directly give the data to the machine, machine cannot understand it. So prior to making the machine to understand the model or develop the model, based on the algorithm what we are going to use, we have a different algorithms are there. So based on the algorithm what we are going to use, we have to convert our business data. Whatever the business data is there, that data has to be converted to a, it has to be gets converted into one statistical model. This is what we call it as a statistical modeling. So the business data needs to be gets converted into a statistical model. That statistical model data should be given to the machine. Machine is going to be trained by itself, and machine is going to develop the that particular model. So after the machine has developed the model, as a machine learning engineer, so we have to evaluate the performance of that. So evaluate the performance of the particular model. How accurately it is predicting the data. So we have given some data, so it is going to do some prediction based on the data. So we are going to compare the actual values, what actually happened versus it is going to be what exactly it has been got predicted. So let us say something like, I will take some data of some cancer patients, for example. I'm going to take some examples of the cancer patients data. So they have some clinical observations are there. So based on the observations, whether the particular person is going to be diagnosed with a cancer or not. So we are going to do the prediction. So what actually happened? So the person has been predicted as a cancer patient. What the machine has been done? The person has been actually not detected as a actual value is it was not affected with the cancer. How the machine is going to be predicted? So we are going to compare the actual versus prediction, and here we are going to calculate what is the percentage of the accuracy and what is the percentage of the error ratio it is going to be. For example, as you know that, how do you calculate the accuracy? How many, for example, I have taken 1,000 observations, for example, out of the 1,000 observations, let us say something around 945 has been predicted correctly. So what is an accuracy ratio? It is nothing but what we call it as 95.5% is the accuracy. And you know that how to calculate the error ratio. Remaining is going to be the error ratio, which will be around some 5.5% is going to be the what we are going to call it as the error ratio it is going to be. So we have to, as a machine learning engineer, so we have to convert the data into the statistical model, make the machine to train the model, evaluate the performance of the model by comparing the actual versus the whatever the predicted values it is going to be. And if there is any techniques, if there is any option for us to improve the performance, so we have to know about the various techniques, how we have to improve the performance. Techniques to improve the performance. So this is exactly what we are going to do as part of the machine learning engineer. So to make the, as part of the statistical modelings, we require a lot of data cleansing techniques. Why? Because the data may not be in a cleansed format. First, we have to convert that particular data into a statistical model. So there only we are going to require some, the data cleansing techniques are going to be required. And while you are doing some analytics, so before training the machine, we also has to do some analytics part. So while doing that particular analytics part, so we should also understand the data. There also we require some data visualization techniques are going to be gets required. So there only in the part of the converting the data into a statistical model, some data cleansing techniques are required. And apart from that, we are going to use some data visualization techniques also. We are going to use as part of the doing some analytics part of the data. And while we are making the machine to be get trained, we have a different kinds of algorithms. Basically in the machine learning, we are going to try to solve various kinds of problems. We are trying to solve various kinds of problems. We are trying to solve it. Generally, I'll make it more and more clear when you go for the machine learning. It is going to be something called as, we are going to try to solve the problems like classification problems, and we are going to do the regression problems. And apart from that, we are going to do something called as a clustering. These are the different kinds of problems, generally what we are going to try to solve in the real time. Classification, regression, and it is going to be clustering. So anyhow, as part of our practical, even for yourself, if you want to, let us say, do some practice on this machine learning, obviously we are going to require some real data is going to be gets required. So we cannot take any sample data and dummy data for us. So we are going to use something like a machine learning community is available. I'm going to use this machine learning community. In this machine learning community, we have a lot of data sets contributed by the various data scientists and various research people. They have contributed this particular data. We have a lot of data sets that are available. We use that particular data sets as part of this particular applications. So this is the website which I'm going to use. It's a machine learning community. We have a lot of data sets. Some around 425 plus number of data sets are going to be gets available. You can choose any kind of these data sets. We can use them. We can download them. There is a lot of life sciences data is there. You can see which kind of area if you want to use is, we can use that particular data. So what area you want to use is, if you can see life sciences data, computer science engineering is there, physical sciences, business, and others data is there. And basically I told about the what are the default type of problems you are trying to solve. Classification, regression, and clustering. These are the main important things what we are going to try to solve it. Anyhow, coming to our application, we'll discuss about that. As actually I told you the, so what is our course curriculum here? So once if we have a course curriculum, so I have given some application yesterday. So I'll share this particular document with you. So we are going to learn about some basic concepts about the R. And even in the machine learning, in this particular free course, we are going to learn, we are going to implement two machine learning algorithms. One is going to be a market basket analysis. That is nothing but in a grocery stores or in the e-commerce sites like Amazon and the eBay. So what kind of combinations mostly the people are buying? So that is what generally we call it as a market basket analysis. So this type of market basket analysis, finding the frequently purchased item in a grocery store, that we do it for the practical algorithm. This algorithm is going to comes under something called as association rules. And we are going to use a one more example, practical example, diagnosing the cancer cells. So this data, I'm going to take it from the machine learning algorithm, the machine learning community. It's one of the popular data sets we can use. So this is a cancer data set. So which has been contributed by one of the hospitals, various hospitals actually, something from the Madison and some of them from the different countries they have been got contributed. You can download this particular data sets. We have these particular data sets are available. We can just download that particular data sets. We can just copy this data and you can put it into one CSV file. And we use this particular data for our machine learning algorithms. But before going to that, what is this data represents? So what are the fields that are available? We can see this application. So we want to diagnose whether it is a malignant data or whether it is a benign data. Malignant is nothing but a cancer cell, which is going to be harmful. Whereas the benign data is not a harmful cancer cell actually. Even a healthy person also going to have a cancer cells in the body, but automatically being to the immunity of the body, so those cancer cells cannot be spread across that. But once the immunity of the person has been decreases, so the cancer cells are going to be gets gross and they are going to be spread across that particular bodies. So malignant and the benign data is there. So malignant are the harmful data, the benign is the non-harmful cancer cells it is. So we do the practical application, detecting whether that particular exactly, whether that particular identification, clinical observations is a, whether it is a, whether it is a cancer cell or not. And we have to identify how accurately it is doing that. So how much percentage of the accuracy? Is it giving 98%, 99%? Even as part of the machine also, every machine does not have the 100% accuracy. At least you will be having 99% of the accuracy must be gets achieved. And anyhow, in some kind of businesses, 90% accuracy is going to be acceptable. No need of going for 100% accuracy. But in life sciences, it must be 100%, it must be accurate. So that is what we are going to do it as part of the machine learning. So as part of the machine learning, I'm going to use a language called as the R is the language what I'm going to use is. I'll tell you in the introduction, as part of the introduction class, I'm not making much about that. So once again, these are the steps what a machine learning engineer has to do. Convert the business data into the statistical modeling. Here he is going to require some visualization and the cleansing techniques. So making the machine to be trained the model, evaluating the performance of the model, actual versus predicted, percentage of accuracy and percentage of errors, and what are the techniques to improve the performance. So this is the exactly the whatever the responsibilities of the machine learning engineer has to do that. So how do you do this? By using a language called as the R is a language what we are going to use is. So most of the people does not know the awareness about this R, but R is a very powerful tool which is going to be comes under something called as it is a statistical computing language. It is a completely a statistical computing language. So which is developed by R community. It's not a commercial product. Actually, it is going to be an open source product. It is an open source product which is going to be distributed by the R community. It is available and it has been distributed through the CRAN. Actually, there is a distribution of the R. So completely the R software, the complete packages, everything is going to be distributed from the distributed by the CRAN. Actually, it's a comprehensive R archive network, we call it as. From the CRAN, we have to download this particular R software. And one of the main thing is R is going to be providing is, so if you have the little bit idea about the Python, here also everything is going to be done by the function only. It's a completely a functional based language. Anything should be done implemented by using functions concept only. And these functions are going to be comes as a packages. We have to just download the packages and we have to attach the package to our environment. And we can start using the functions that are available in the package. That is what exactly we are going to do it in R. So if you want to download the R software, so just go to the Google and just type R. So we are going to just type the R. You are going to get the R, the project official website is going to be gets coming, which is going to be R project hyphen r-project.org. So we can see here R is a free software environment for statistical computing and graphics. It compiles and runs on variety of systems, any Mac system, or it may be Windows, or it may be any Mac Unix systems. And to download the R, please choose your preferred CRAN mirrors. So R is a programming language and free software environment for statistical computing and graphics that is supported by the R Foundation for Statistical Computing. So first appeared in 1993, almost 24 years ago. And currently, and the recently it has been released is 3.4.4 is the latest release. Actually, on March 15th only it has been released. And it has been a general release in the general public license. Anybody's they can use it. And the extensions are going to be something like R, RMD, R data. We have this kind of extensions is going to be. I'll tell you about some history about that R. Actually, the R has been inherited from another statistical computing language called as it has been derived from S and S plus. These are the commercial products. Actually, these are the commercial products of statistical computing. R is actually what we call it as. Actually, the R was invented at one University of Auckland. It is invented at the University of the Auckland in that is in New Zealand, Auckland. So what we call it as a this particular R is nothing but what we call it as the teaching version of R. Sorry, the teaching version of the S and S plus. The teaching version of the S and S plus is nothing but what we are going to call it as R. So it was invented at the University of the Auckland in New Zealand, and it is a teaching version of S and S plus. If you want to download the R, you can go to the R community. You can just go to that particular R page, the official page it is going to be. So you can see here, it's the latest version is going to be 3.4.4. It was recently released. And if you can see, there is an R version is coming, 3.5.0 is coming actually. Will appear starting on 23rd. It's the final release is to be scheduled on 23rd April. But initially the beta version is going to be gets released. So whenever you want to download the R, So we can just click on this particular download R. So you can see here, these are different CRAN mirrors. The comprehensive R archive network is available at the following URLs. You can choose your location, which is close to you. You can choose, even I'm working from India, so I'm going to use the Indian mirror it is, which one is provided by the IIT Madras. So the Indian Institute of Technology Madras is providing. So you can just download the particular files, the software from this particular CRAN mirrors it is going to be. So it is the Indian Institute of Technology that IIT Madras is providing. So you can just download from them also. So through the FTP there are going to be, and you can see, most of them are nothing but the universities and institutes only. So this is the actual one. University of Auckland is providing this one actually. You can download. So which one is the nearest one? You better select the nearest one. Why? Because it is downloading through the FTP. So if there is a nearer one, it is going to be downloads faster actually. I already downloaded and installation is very easy. You can do the installation. So just click on that. It will connect to the CRAN mirror. It will be connected to that particular CRAN mirror. It's going to be gets connected and we can it will be gets downloaded. Once if you click on that, it will be gets downloaded and we can start working on that. We can work on that. Actually right now it is okay. These are the CRAN mirrors. You can just select it actually. But maybe sometimes the CRAN mirrors maybe gets down. So it does not matter. You can work on that particular one. So otherwise you can choose any other FTP, we can use it. Or I use this my cloud, does not matter, from anywhere you can download it actually. Okay, so my Indian is not working right now. So I have used the cloud itself. So download the R for Linux, download the R for Mac, download the R for Windows. You can just click on that. So install the R for the first time, around 78 MB is going to be the file. It will be gets downloaded. Download 3.4.4 for Windows and 3.5.0 is ready to release in the coming next 1 month. It is going to be gets releases. So you can just click on that particular download R and software will be installed, downloaded, and you can start installation. Once if you have installed the software, it will ask you whether you want to go for 64-bit or 32-bit. You can select both of them if you want to use it. I have selected only 64-bit only. So if you can see, these are the version. 3.4.3 is available and 3.4.4 is available. Just double click on that. Just open that particular software. So it is going to be what we are going to call it as the R console. It is going to be gets coming. This is an R console. Apart from that, we are having a one more better IDE is available. For that particular IDE, I'm going to use as something called as the R Studio. We are going to use as. We have a one more software is there. This is going to be only the R console itself. But if you want to work with a better IDE, so we are having the R Studio is going to be gets available. So you can work with the R Studio. So we'll discuss it later. The R Studio is nothing but an integrated development interface for the R language. So it is an integrated development environment for the R. So we'll download this particular R itself. Like for Java program, how we use Eclipse. Same as it is for here, we are going to work with the R Studio. We are going to work with that. There is a free version is available. Even there are some commercial products actually. So download the R Studio. So there will be a free desktop version will be available. You can download that particular desktop version. It's a free version actually. Don't go for server one. You have to download the desktop version. Download and install it. The R Studio environment will look like this. A more and more enhanced features will be there. You can work with that particular R Studio. This is my R Studio. I can just work on that particular R Studio. So more and more features will be there. Everything is going to be anything you can get it from the menu options. IntelliSense will work. A lot of things are going to be gets working here. And even the R Studio also comes with the R console itself. But apart from R console, we have a different type of editors will be available. Will work with all the different kinds of editors. This is an R console where we can work with that particular console applications. Both are the same. This is an R console and this is also going to be an R console. Same thing is going to be gets coming. Anything is a fine case. You can start working with the commands. This, for example, I'm telling A equals to 10. A equals to 10 and B equals, I can increase the font size, does not matter. C equals to A plus B, and I can print the value of C it is. Here also the same thing, I can write it, A equals to 10, A equals to 10, B equals to 20, C equals to A plus B. There is no declaration parts. Directly we can use them. It's a dynamically typed languages. Like a programming language, we need not to declare the data types. But internally data types is there, but we don't define them. Dynamically system is going to be gets taken. If I want to know the data type, I'll say type of the C, it is going to tell you that it is a double data type. When you work with Python, in the Python is also, it is going to be the same way. So I'm also going to use as the Python for this, does not matter. So this is my Python prompt, or you can use the Python ID, the IDs are available. Even in the command prompt also we can execute. A equals to 10 and B equals to 20, it's a dynamic type of language. B equals to 20, and I'm going to say C equals to A plus B, and print the value of C. You can say print C, or even we can say directly C also. But in programming languages, we don't say, but here we have to say type of. It's not type of, it is just type whatever the C value it is going to be. So it is going to say that it is going to belongs to a class called as an integer class. And here it is going to belongs to a class called as a double class. Actually, it's not a class actually. We have a class of C that is going to be says that it is a numeric class it is going to be. R is a very powerful language for basic machine learnings. The R is better than the Python. If you want to go for a advanced levels, like we have a neural networks and we are having something like a artificial intelligence, then they prefer to use as the Pythons. Like if you want to develop the chatbots, so we use as the Python is the language for developing of chatbots. We are going to use the Python. We can also develop it. Google also provides a lot of online tutorials are available to develop the chatbots. So we can develop that particular chatbots and we can work on that also. So this is just a basic idea about what is exactly the machine learning. So in a machine learning, we are going to give the data to the machine in a statistical modeling. Machine understands, analyzes, and develops a predictive model. As a machine learning engineer, we have to evaluate the performance of the particular model, and we have to improve the performance of the particular model. For that, I'm going to use the R language. So I have told you how to download the software in the R. So you can just download the R and you can start working. From the next session, I'm going to start with the practicals, how to work with the R itself. So meanwhile, if you all want to work with the, if you also want to practice on your systems, download the R software. It's very user friendly to install it, download it, and open that particular R console. First, initially we work with the R console. Later, I'm going to work with the R Studio. We are going to work on that. R Studio provides a lot of enhancements. So in the next session, we'll discuss about how we are going to set up the environments. Now ready to use, but how to set up the environments. We require a lot of packages to be working. So how to download the packages, how to install the packages, how to attach the packages, how to see the list of the packages. Anyhow, we'll discuss it once again. It's a completely functional based language. Anything should be done by using function only. If I execute the function, it will tell you these are the packages currently that are attached. So any function which is the part of the package, now it is ready to use and you can start working with that particular applications. Okay, so anyhow, I'll make this particular practical application in the next session. So meanwhile, for the today's session, so please download that particular R software and make it ready for the next session. The next session will start with the practicals concepts. Okay, so now if you have any questions, I can answer the questions now. You can just use a chat panel, so for typing the questions. So I'm going to answer all the questions.